for joining today's Microsoft Virtual Academy, where we'll be helping you to get the most out of your Office 365 account. I'm not alone in the studio today. With me is Benolo Sedupani. Benolo, please introduce yourself and tell us a bit about what you do at Microsoft.
Well, I am Benolo Sedupani, as you already mentioned. I am a teacher ambassador at Microsoft. So we work with different teachers from different learning environments on how to leverage using Microsoft education tools in the classroom.
So Benolo, I think we've got just the right person in studio today because you help lots of teachers and lots of schools make the most out of their Office 365 accounts.
Yes, definitely.
And today we're going to be talking about what to do if you've now been given an Office 365 account, your school or your institution or your Department of Education has signed up and got teachers on board. And how can teachers now take the tools that are available and make the most of them?
Absolutely.
So Benolo, the first thing that a teacher would need to know is how to access their Office 365 account. Can you log into yours and sort of talk us through the steps of getting in?
So it's exciting to get a new device. There's a lot of opportunities that you can access through this wonderful device that you've been provided by the school or the Department of Education, but what to do from it? So your school would have deployed Office 365, and that means you have an Office 365 account, which gives you access to various applications that you can use for teaching and also communicating with other teachers and everyone around the world. So this is how you would actually go about accessing that account. You open a browser, and inside the URL tab, you will type in portal.office365.com. This is where you put in your credentials to be able to sign in. By credentials, I mean you would need to have a username that will be provided by your school as well as a password.
So you'd need to be connected to the internet to access your Office 365 account.
Yes, you would need to be connected to the internet.
And that that username, that's usually a teacher's email address that they've been given by the school.
The naming conventions differ from school to school. So for example, the schools, some of them would use maybe an employee number at your domain account for the email address, or your name.surname, and then the password. It will be a standard one when your IT person is setting it up, but then you would have to change it yourself to make it more secure so that no one can access your work but yourself. Yeah.
Okay, and you'd get that username, that email address and that password from your school's IT person or your department person who sets
yes.
the account up.
The username will be provided for you.
Okay, and then once you've clicked the button and opened up your account, you'll see something like what you're looking at now.
Yes, so this will be your landing page. And this is exactly all the applications that you have access to. So as you can see, there are some applications that you might be familiar with. For example, your Word that you have probably used to type in your assignments while you were still in school, or also to set up your lesson plans, and also PowerPoint, Megan, for presentations. I don't know, have you used PowerPoint for presentations before?
So most teachers, I'm sure, will be quite familiar with sort of tools like PowerPoint to make presentations, or perhaps they've used Excel before to
yes.
do their mark sheets, or maybe they've used Microsoft Word to type tests or exam papers, or perhaps letters to parents. But each of those little icons represents a different app that's available through Office 365.
Yes, that's true.
What are some of the new ones that teachers maybe are not so familiar with that they can try out now?
Well, I think the most important one that I would recommend they start with would be your OneDrive. Because OneDrive is where you'd be actually saving all your information. So if you're using any of these applications, whether OneNote or Class Notebook or Sway or Forms, all of this stuff you'll be saving from OneDrive. So how have you used OneDrive, Megan?
So basically, OneDrive is like my my filing cabinets in the sky. You know, when I was a teacher, I still had, you know, hard copy files and had all of my prep for my various subjects in those. But using a tool like OneDrive, teachers can basically have their filing cabinets in the sky. Yeah. And it's then impossible to lose those documents.
Yeah, definitely. So I have found OneDrive to be very useful as well. I have used it to save even my pictures, music. There's quite a big storage there, because sometimes you get that you're using your flash disk, you have your lesson plans in there, but then you forget it. Maybe you were copying Megan's computer and then you forget it there, and then Megan is out of town and she's misplaced it also. So you lose in
Or they're easy to misplace. You know, yes. A little flash drive is very easy to lose, or sometimes they get corrupted. Exactly. and you've lost all of your data.
Yes, that's correct. So for that, you would use OneDrive, because even if you sign in from your computer at work or even at home, using the same username and password provided by your school, you still have access to all your work. So that is the beauty of using OneDrive. And this is how you would actually go about creating and saving files in OneDrive. So you'll click on your OneDrive app from your landing page. So from the OneDrive, you have access. So these are the files that I have already saved from using my own hard drive. So as you can see, it's different formats. So there's Word, OneNote, My Task, folders. You can create folders in there, so if you want to group your information. So it works exactly like the hard drive and USB that you have used to use.
And teachers who've perhaps already got documents created, maybe on their computer at home or on a previous laptop that they've owned, they could take those documents and now save them to their Office 365 account.
Yes, exactly. So it's just easy. You plug it in and you just move them across.
Okay.
So you would go on to, I've opened my OneDrive. So you would go on to New. So you see, when you type and click on New, it gives you the type of files that you are able to create. So it just up to you. If you wanted to create a Word document, you would click on Word. If you wanted to create an Excel document, you would click on that. So that is how I found it too easy to use my OneDrive.
Okay. We mentioned earlier that there's some apps in Office 365 that teachers might already be familiar with, Word, PowerPoint, Excel, but there are a couple of new icons there that maybe teachers haven't seen before. You mentioned Sway as one of them. Do you want to tell us quickly what Sway is all about?
Okay, Sway, let me go back on here. So Sway is a digital storytelling tool. So it's much like PowerPoint, but better, because it has all these beautiful features where you can put in pictures in a stack, you can, or maybe in a grid form, and whatever information that you're searching from the internet is already referenced for you. So the other beauty about Sway is that, unlike with PowerPoint, when you open a new PowerPoint presentation, you have a blank slide. So with Sway, you can decide to whether you want to start from a topic or from an existing document. So if you have a lesson plan, or if you've had maybe a presentation on a particular topic and you want to create a Sway from that, you can actually go onto the document and create a Sway from there. So I'm just going to show you how you access it. You can go from your landing page, access Sway, or if you have already opened another app, like I did here, open the OneDrive, you just go onto this little waffle looking icon on your top left, and then you will get access to the applications without going back to the landing page. So there's my Sway. I open Sway. So Sway can be used by teachers, also learners. They'll find it as a very exciting tool for reflection. So you can start from a topic or from a document, as I mentioned earlier, or create a blank new one altogether. So we can start from a topic. So what can we read a topic sway on again?
So say it's going to be foundation phase teachers and they've got a topic on colors.
Colors. So it creates an outline for you. Do you just want to go color? It already gives a couple of suggestions in terms of topics or sections that you can cover relating to your topic.
Okay.
So we'll go create outline.
And this is really nice for a teacher that's looking for a fun sort of new way of introducing a topic, making their lessons more visually stimulating. And showing kids things that are maybe difficult to bring into the classroom. So including more visual images, sort of experiences that are hard to replicate without taking kids on a field trip, or you know, you can bring that excitement to the class through sway.
Exactly. And you are also able to, as you mentioned, Megan, to put in pictures into your sway. So even if you have existing pictures from your sway, you are also able to search for pictures from the internet and insert them directly onto your sway.
So either existing pictures already uploaded perhaps to your OneDrive,
yes.
Or ones that you search for. And then you can change the background, you can change how it looks.
Yes. So I will go here onto the background. So can you see that because of the topic that I have selected, when I go background, it will give me suggestions in terms of what I can put in there. So you can select from your background or from your device, or from what your OneDrive. So I will go, as I mentioned, that you're able to search for the pictures on the internet. So if you don't have pictures already saved on your device or in your OneDrive, you can actually go on to the internet and search pictures from there. So this is the suggestions that it will have for you, and I see, okay, this one looks more appealing to me. I wanna make this at my background for my sway, then I can just drag it and drop it there.
Nice.
Yes. And then you're also able to add other features onto your sway. So if you want to put more images, or you put text, let's say for example, with this colors, I want my learners to have a little background. Why do we call it learners, the colors, and where does it come from? How do we use these colors? So I can come and put a text card and maybe go on to get some information. So you see some information is already outlined there in terms of the topic. So I can actually maybe go on to my Wikipedia and say colors if I want to have more information regarding this.
So it's really a quick way for teachers to sort of produce new learning resources that they can use in the classroom.
Exactly.
And older learners can have a go at creating a sway themselves. So instead of just having to present sort of work in the form of a test or an essay, they can actually make a sway and present their information visually.
Yes, and it's actually a very good reflection tool as well, because as you allow the learners to create not their own knowledge based on what they've been taught in class and they put it in a sway, you'd be amazed, teacher, to see what they have actually taken out of the lesson from what they put into their sways.
Yeah, another thing that's really nice about Sway, and actually most of the Office 365 tools, is different people can collaborate on the same document.
Yes.
So one person could start off the Sway, like you started yours on colors, and if we were colleagues both teaching the same topic, you could send me a link to be able to edit your Sway. And if I found some added pictures or some extra information, I could put my stuff into your sway and it could then become our sway.
Yes, definitely. And this is how you would actually share it. There is a share button right at the top right. And then you choose how you actually want to share the sway. Do you want to share it with everyone or only people that you provide the link to? And also you set permissions. If I am inviting or sending the sway to Megan, do I want you to be able to edit it, or do I just want you to see what I'm doing? So you give them those permissions as well.
Okay. So Benolo Sway is just one of the many tools that are available through somebody's Office 365 account. We've talked about Word, we've talked about PowerPoint, we've talked about Excel, and now Sway. Sway is only available online, but other tools like Word, PowerPoint, Excel, what happens if a teacher maybe wants to be able to use those apps at home where they maybe don't have internet access? Is it possible to do that?
Yes, definitely. So with your Office 365, you actually have access to install your applications on 15 devices, five of which would be your tablet, five your desktop, and five your mobile devices, like your maybe your cell phone. So on your landing page, there's this tab here where it says install Office applications. So when you say install, when you click on install applications, it shows you that you'll actually be able to have all these applications offline. So it says here it includes Outlook, OneDrive for Business, Word, Excel, PowerPoint, like the normal Office package. So you can have them available offline.
So a teacher who maybe wanted to make a new worksheet at home could download the offline version of Word, could work on her worksheet at home, and the next time she has internet access, would those documents sync and the latest version would be available?
Yes, so the latest version of the information on the document will be available. So as soon as you get internet access, everything syncs onto your OneDrive, so that even if you are connecting onto a work, maybe you're working at home and you're working, now you're accessing your work from your work device, it will be the same information. So whatever you're doing offline, as soon as you get internet connectivity, it synchronizes onto your online version.
So that's really handy for teachers. You know, devices sometimes get stolen, sometimes they crash. If you've got your stuff backed up all the time onto the cloud, if something happens to one of your devices, you'll only lose maybe that small amount of work that you did at home before you'd connected again.
Yes, that's true. And the beauty about some of these apps is that, for example, if you're working on your OneNote or Word online, you don't have to continually save when you as you're working on your document. It automatically saves for you. So you just need to remember to save when you're working offline. But when you're online, it's automatically done for you.
Okay, well that's another big help. You know, teachers don't want to lose their work and sort of something they've spent a lot of time on. Also, we talked about it when we referred to the Sway example, but lots of these documents are available for collaborative editing. So we talked about a teacher maybe creating a new worksheet at home. Would a teacher be able to share that document with colleagues so they could have a look at it and perhaps sort of suggest some other questions?
Yes, definitely, that is possible. So with information, let's say, for example, we're working on an exam paper, and then instead of me printing it out, putting this information and going back and forth on it, we can actually work on the same document at the same time.
So that would be really handy at a school if maybe your head of department needs to moderate an exam paper. You could, instead of printing it, you could share it with him or her electronically, and they could look at it right then and there and make any adjustments that are required.
Yes, that is true, definitely.
So show us how that works.
So you would open your OneDrive and locate the document that you actually want to share. So I'll show you this one with, for example, activities. This is the one that I wanted my learners to work on with creating their Sway. So what I wanted to do was actually have all the learners put in suggestion in terms of what should be covered, so that even though the Sways are gonna look different, but they still cover the same topics. So you'd open the document and then go on to share. So as you go on to share, it will actually populate this tab for you where you can put in the person's email address. So they don't have to be in within the same school. So even if they're outside the same school, as long as you have their email address, you can invite them to share the document with you.
So that's really nice for teachers that are perhaps in a cluster and want to share resources between schools. You know, maybe one teacher's made a really nice worksheet or has set a really nice test, and other teachers teaching that same subject at neighboring schools might want to share it and look at it too.
Yes.
So Benolo, that's how to share documents and some of the main apps that are available. One of the ones that teachers will probably find the most useful is using their Office 365 account to send and receive emails. Can you show us how to do that through an Office 365 account? Which of those apps should they click on? Which one's the email one?
So again, on your landing page, you see Outlook, so you would use Outlook for your emails. So you'd use this specifically for setting up your calendar for if you have meetings. So also you can set up your schedule in terms of you know what you need to do and when. But most importantly, effective communication, because if I want to tell Megan something, I don't have to wait till tea break to tell them something. So I can just send them an email and then they can respond at a time that is also convenient for them as well. So this is the email. This is how it would look like. So as you can see, mine is people have already sent me emails. So you come to this tab here that says new, and then you will put in the person's email address. So let's say, for example, I'm sending a colleague of mine, Ronelle. So if the person you're trying to communicate with is already within the school, it will most probably populate the email address.
So as you type the first couple of letters, it will sort of start guessing who that might be sending it to.
Yes.
And you just need to confirm that's right.
The person. So maybe if it's somebody that is outside your school, you'd have to type in the whole email address. But as soon as you type the email to them again, it will remember that you've actually communicated with this person before, and it will suggest the email address for you.
So perhaps if you're sending an email to a parent, it wouldn't be in Outlook the first time.
Yes.
But if you sent that same parent an email again the following week, it would start to guess who that mail might be going to from the first few letters.
Yes, exactly. So let's say, for example, this is my HOD and I need to send her my exam papers that she can moderate, but I'm teaching the same subject with Megan. So I want to send to Megan, it's a bit long, or Angela. So I will copy Angela onto my email, because we're teaching the same subject, so that she can see the response that I'm getting from the HOD, and then I would say exam.
So if you give your email a sort of subject line, it makes it easier for people to keep track of their emails and know, this is what the topic of the email is all about.
Yes. So I can type here and say what it is that I want to say. I can also attach the file. So if I've already created it using my Word document, which I have saved on my OneDrive, then I can just go and attach it from there. So I can just send it from the computer, so whichever location that I've saved it to, and then click send.
Okay. And you can type something in the sort of body of the email too, a little message. Here's my exam paper, please look at it, and let me know what you think. And then the person can reply.
Yeah, so the same analogy as writing a letter. So this is just electronic. So you would start with your greetings, maybe dear Angela, dear Ronelle, and then get into the body of your message in terms of what it is that you're communicating to the next person.
And sometimes with the little icons that are used, you can almost sort of guess what's going on. So Outlook, the icon is like a little envelope, because that's like sending somebody a letter, just a much faster way of doing it.
Yes,
and if you're you're attaching something, like you were attaching an exam paper, it looks like a little paper clip, because that's almost like you'd send somebody a note saying, you know, here's my exam paper, please have a look, and you then paper clip on the actual exam paper and send it with your note.
Yes, and you can attach different types of files. You can attach pictures as well, or PDF files. So it's different types of files that you're able to attach as well. So for example, here I will be attaching a PowerPoint presentation. So maybe I want Ronelle to go over my PowerPoint presentation for the big presentations that I'm having, maybe for principals tomorrow. And then she can go over the PowerPoint and make some suggestions.
And then when somebody gets one of those emails, they can then click on the reply button and say, thanks, Manolo, I've had a look. It looks great. And they'll either say reply if they're replying just to the person who sent it to them, or they'll say reply all if they want everyone who was copied on the original mail to be copied on the reply.
Yes. And this is how it would look. So I would have this mail. So the person who's receiving the email that is sent, it will actually come in this format into their mailbox. So it will actually come in this format into their mailbox. So when they open their email, so this is how it looked like. This is the contents of the email. So this is the reply and reply all that Megan was talking about. So this is where you would get it. So can you see that once I've clicked like reply, it actually shows who you're replying to, and then you can type in your message and click send.
Okay, so really email can help teachers to work faster and smarter. Yeah. As you were saying earlier, they don't need to wait until tea break to see somebody. And also you can save the trees. Instead of continually printing out documents, you can send them to somebody, they can look at them electronically, they can make any changes there that are required to your documents, and can then send it back without having to print them at each stage.
Yes, that is true.
So, Benola, we have mentioned it briefly, but it's so important, I just want to recap it again. OneDrive works a little bit like a digital filing cabinet. We talked about that earlier. And you were saying that with an Office 365 account, you can download it on different devices. If you've got a laptop that's been issued to you by work, does that then mean you can only get your email or your documents on your work device, or would you be able to access that OneDrive filing cabinet from other devices?
Yes, you most definitely can access that one, your work, from any device. Like I mentioned that you can install it in different devices. So with your account subscription, I don't know if that's the right word, you are allowed to download on 15 devices, 5 of which would be desktops, 5 would be like your tablets, mobile devices, and the other 5 would be like your phone. So if you're using like a Samsung J5, so your Android phones, or the beauty about it is that it also works across all platforms. So whether it's a Mac or an Android or Windows phone, you can still install your offline versions on those devices. And what you would need to be able to do that is your username that has been provided by your school, using the naming convention that has been decided by the school or the department. That is very important. And the password that you're using for that account. So every time when you sign in, whether you're signing in from your device at home or the one that you're borrowing at a friend's house, or maybe you forgot an important email that you need to send but you're at a tea party, you can just, you know, get an email, a device with internet access, use that username and password to access your information.
Okay, so there's a bit of a difference. If you want to download the actual software and have offline copies, you can only do that on 15 devices.
Yes.
But if you've got your username and password, you can actually access your content from anywhere.
Yes.
Like even that screen that's in front of you now, that's not your regular screen.
No,
you know, this is not our office. This is not where we work.
Exactly.
But just because you knew your username and password, you were able to quickly type it in. And there were your documents, just like when you look at your laptop or when you look at your phone.
Yes.
And if you needed to send a quick email, you could do that right there from this device, even
yes.
although it's not your regular device or one of the 15 devices that you've installed software on.
Yeah, so you can see it as your master key to opening all the doors inside your Office 365 world.
So what's that URL again that people should go to? It's
portal.office.com.
Portal.office.com.
Yes.
And then just know your username and your password, and you've got the master key to access your documents on any device.
Yes, definitely.
So, Benolo, if somebody's got an Office 365 account and they're working at a school and their school's issued them with a laptop, they're going to save a lot of their prep on that device and in the cloud. But what happens if a teacher leaves a school? What happens to all of that information that they've been diligently saving in their electronic filing cabinet?
Okay, this differs from school to school because the school policies are different. So for example, the school that I previously used to work for, we had a 2-year policy rule that if somebody have left the school or if the learner have left the school, we keep their information for 2 years. So what would happen is from the IT side, maybe from the Active Directory, would actually put this in a different distribution list or create a group that called maybe alumni or staff that have left, whichever one you would prefer to call it. So within that group, we know that all the accounts that are there are no longer active. So they won't be active, but the information will still remain inside those accounts. So maybe after 2 years, as an IT department, we discuss, okay, maybe because we need to get rid of the dormant accounts, then we do an Active Directory cleanup. So all the accounts that have been inactive for a certain amount of time then would be deleted. So some schools can make it like 5 years, or for some would keep it forever, because we get, especially with the school, we have like sensitive information. So maybe we'll get that a teacher was teaching a certain grade and there was a child that had special needs, and there was a case that was built against, you know, in terms of helping them with their progress or something like that, they would actually maybe go to the email to say, how has the teacher handled the situation, the communication between the parents, the information in terms of the work that the learner was doing with the teacher, the worksheets that they completed that were given back to the teacher, and some information like that. So depending on the sensitivity of the information or the role of the person, because, for example, a teacher and maybe a deputy principal would have the importance, or not like importance is not a good word, like the role that they're playing in the school would differ in terms of how they're executing the tasks for the school. So maybe if I'm a deputy principal and a teacher leaves, and a deputy principal was engaging with more schools locally and internationally, would want to keep their profile inactive but present for a much longer time than a teacher who was just maybe a netball coach.
Okay. So sort of in short, we'd suggest to teachers that they find out what their school's policy is,
yes.
regarding if you leave the school. And also, if teachers want to set up their own personal Microsoft account,
yes.
They could definitely do that from their same device.
Mm-hmm.
And if you've got personal information that you want to save, maybe photos, maybe scans of your personal documents, you could certainly save those to your personal OneDrive, and you'd have the username and password for that to carry on accessing those documents from anywhere, anytime, any place. And even if teachers wanted to save copies of worksheets or tests or PowerPoints that they'd made to use at one school and perhaps they move to another school, they could save copies of those to their personal Microsoft yes. account, and they would still then have access to that prep at a later date at another school.
Yes, definitely.
But do bear in mind your school's privacy policies, particularly if you're working with sensitive information. Don't then save that information to a personal Microsoft account, because really it could get into the wrong hands. But if it's your own information or documents you've created, by all means, save a copy.
Yes.
So Bernardo, that brings us to the end of our quick tour through Office 365. I do hope that teachers will use it and make the most of some of those cool apps and features.
Oh, already. I mean, there is so much more that you can do with Office 365. But I would think and say that as a teacher, you're introduced to these new devices, this new exciting platform. You might get overwhelmed in terms of there's so much that I have to learn. I think just pick one thing that works for you. Start with the platform that's already familiar to you, like your Word, save them to your OneDrive, your PowerPoint, save there. And then as you get more comfortable, go onto your Sway, explore OneNote, explore forms for assessment. There's just so much more that you can do, but it all depends on what you need it for in your classroom.
Bernardo, I think that's excellent advice. Thank you so much for sharing your tips and pointers with teachers getting started with Office 365. Definitely start with the familiar and then do try out some of those new apps, those new tools. And as you get more and more confident, you'll find yourself using your Office 365 account more and more. Please join us for the next Microsoft Virtual Academy, where we'll give you some more tips and tricks for making better use of your new device. Goodbye.